He has lectured and given seminars in a number of British universities, schools, and cultural and educational institutions, including Derby, Newcastle, and Nottingham Universities, and the Cervantes Institute in London. He blogs at infernomachine.co.uk. Matt Carr will be speaking on the oppression of the Morisco peoples in post-Islamic Andalusia.
I'd like to thank the Islamic Human Rights Commission for inviting me here to talk to you about the Moriscos. I'm always glad to talk about the Moriscos, partly because it's a crucial episode in Spanish history, in European history, in Islamic history, and I was particularly glad to talk about it today on Genocide Memorial Day, because it's an episode that is often overlooked by genocide scholarship, even though it can be seen, to my mind, as a kind of precedent for many of the acts of violence that we associate with the modern world of the 20th century. Oh yeah, sorry, okay. So. My talk, to some extent, is going to overlap with Maria Jose's excellent talk, which she put a lot of emphasis on the kind of psychological dynamics that you find in genocidal episodes that she traced and compared between Nazi Germany and what took place in Moriscos. I'm not going to do that because I'm not a psychologist. I'm a writer who writes about history, and the book I wrote, Blood and Faith, Expulsion of the Persian Muslims in Spain, took a look at that episode as a kind of precedent. Not only for genocidal ethnic cleansing events, but also particularly looking at Islamophobia in modern Europe and looking at these parallels. I know some historians don't like that. They don't like you to make parallels. They don't like you to make comparisons. They say it's not historical. They say you run the risk of anachronisms and so on and so forth. All this is true. That can happen. But I always believe that history is a tool, a vital tool that we can use, that we must use, if we have any chance of constructing better societies, that we can use it to fight racism, we can use it to fight prejudice, we can use it to create the societies that we all want based on peace and coexistence and equality. So I'm quite happy to make parallels and to make precedents, although obviously talking about the Moriscos, you have to bear in mind you're dealing at a very different period of history, 400 years ago, when there were assumptions that people had, the rulers had, the states had, that were very different from the way states are run now and from the way societies could perceive themselves. The theme of today's Genocide Memorial Day is the political, social, and economic processes that precede all genocides and which provide an indicator of looming crisis. So I've just got a little list I've compiled here of certain features which I think repeat in these episodes. You may have your own you want to add. I thought the whole discussion after Maria Jose's talk was raised a lot of really interesting issues, which hopefully will come up during my talk and perhaps afterwards. Anyway, some of the things I've mentioned. The fear and loathing of a marginalized group perceived by a powerful majority as intruders or usurpers in a particular territory. The perception of that group as inferior and even subhuman, whether that inferiority is defined in terms of religion, skin color, ethnicity, nationality, or biology. The perception of that group as an existential threat to the identity of the majority in cultural and also in security terms. The idea that this group might not only be culturally incompatible with the values, so-called values of the majority, but the idea that this group might even be a fifth column and an enemy within, possibly linked to even more powerful external enemies. And there's one other thing I'd like to add, of course, which is in order for genocides to happen, you have to have a powerful state with the will and the ability to carry it out. So all these characteristics apply to some extent to the expulsion of the Moriscos. Some historians have described the expulsion of the Moriscos, they call it the Morisco tragedy. Obviously, it is a tragedy. If you forcibly make 350,000 odd people leave their homes and send them to nowhere, many of them die and killed, that is a tragedy. But it's also a crime. I call it a historical crime. But I also accept to some extent the notion of tragedy, because the historians of the 20th century, there were some pro-fascist historians in the 1930s who wrote to some extent about the Moriscos. One of them is J.F.C. Fuller, our own military historian J.F.C. Fuller. When they wrote about the expulsion of the Moriscos, they described it as if it was a kind of biological expulsion of something that didn't belong, as if Spain recovered its true self by expelling this vile thing that was inside it. That's how they described it. But actually, if you look closer at the history, There were people at that time who did perceive the expulsion in those terms, but there was also a lot of bad policy, mistakes, wrong turns, U-turns. In other words, the expulsion of the Moriscos was not inevitable. It didn't have to happen, even within the parameters of that time. So I'm going to mention a little bit of that as well. There isn't enough time to go into the whole complexity of this period. We're dealing about 100 years, 109 years, and in fact a lot more if you look at the background that preceded the expulsion. So I'm just going to touch on some of the main features. Basically, the Morisco problem begins soon after this. As Maria Jose said, this was 1492, Spain's miraculous year, the unification of Spain under Christian rule, the formal destruction of Islam in Spain. The formal, I say that, because many people have often thought that with this event, the surrender of the Alhambra Palace, Ferdinand and Isabella taking the surrender, that was when Islam was finished in Spain. Well, obviously, politically, yes, militarily, yes, but there remained after the fall of Granada some 500,000 to 600,000 Muslims living across Spain in very difficult, very different circumstances. Some of them were virtually indistinguishable from Christians in the way they looked, in the way they talked. They didn't speak Arabic. They had varying degrees of attachment to Islam. Some of them were very devout. Some of them were not so devout. Some of them wanted to be devout but couldn't be because they had no religious teachers to tell them what they were supposed to be studying. So you had a very sort of variegated Muslim population scattered across Spain, mostly drawn from the proletarian base of Al-Andalus. There weren't very many rich Moriscos. There were some, but most of them are artisans, peasants, gardeners, musicians, jugglers, and so on. So a powerless population, basically. And so when Ferdinand and Isabella took control of Granada, this population was a problem for them. Why? Because for the last 100-odd years, Christian rulers in Spain had been trying to enforce religious uniformity on the whole population that they controlled. This process began with the Jews at the end of the 14th century, when thousands of Jews were forcibly converted to Catholicism, at the point of a sword, usually. And then after that, this was a dynamic, very important to bear this in mind, because this is crucial to understanding what happened with the Moriscos. When Spain's rulers had forcibly converted the Jews, they then created a dynamic that was very, very difficult to control. What they had said was, in a way, if I can say this, they were saying to Spanish Jews, we do not want you to exist as Jews, because we despise you. Therefore, you must become Catholics. But once they'd actually forced them to do it, they never really believed that they actually were sincere Catholics. So they set in motion this whole process, which introduced concept of purity of blood. Purity of blood is a concept that was developed in the 15th century, because once they'd converted all these Jews, there was a strong reaction against this. Many Christians were saying, oh no, we're not having Jews. They're not sincere, even when they're inside us, they're not real Catholics. They're pretending to be Catholics, which actually makes them heretics and actually makes them dangerous to us. So this ideology called purity of blood developed, and the idea was that those who had pure blood were Christians, so-called old Christians, who could trace their origins right back to the Visigoths, to the Roman times, and so on. Whereas the Jewish converts were conversos. They were new Christians. So they were only partly belonging to the kind of body of Christian society. So then Ferdinand and Isabella created the Spanish Inquisition to try and police Spanish Jewry. But they still believed that Spanish Jews were not really becoming Christians. And they believed that one of the reasons for this was because many Jews remained unconverted. As well as the Jews that had become Catholics, there was a large Jewish population that continued to worship as Jews. So in 1492, Ferdinand and Isabella, as Maria Jose said earlier, expelled them. But this expulsion was very different from the expulsion of the Moriscos, because Ferdinand and Isabella gave them a choice. They said, you can become Catholics, you can stay. If you continue to worship as Jews, you leave. That choice wasn't given to the Moriscos 100-odd years later. And that's and to understand why that happened, we need to kind of have a look at some of the dynamics. So when in 1492, there were leading Christians, influential Christians within the church, who said, okay, we now control Spain. We've now controlled Granada. Therefore, why don't we just simply expel all the infidels, as they were known as? Why don't we get rid of them all? Ferdinand and Isabella didn't do this. They did consider it. They listened to those arguments. They didn't do this. Why didn't they do this? Partly because it was just too difficult. because by this time there were Christian landowners all over Spain who depended on Muslim labor to run their estates. So economically it was difficult. From security terms it was difficult because Christian power was still not fully consolidated in Spain in 1492. There was still the risk that if there was a rebellion, then there could be problems, for example, with Turkish rulers and their satraps in North Africa and so on. So Ferdinand Isabella said, no, we're not going to do that. We're going to pass laws. And then what they did was they passed very, very, in the terms of the time, liberal laws, in which they said to the Muslims of Granada, you can continue to worship as Muslims. There won't be a problem. This is guaranteed for you and so on. But then, a few years later, Cardinal Cisneros, the Archbishop of Toledo, arrived in Granada. And he was very, very fanatical anti-Muslim cleric. When he came to Granada, he was shocked by how many mosques there were, by the fact that so many of the mosques were filled with Muslims who were worshipping openly as Muslims. He found it intolerable. He wouldn't stand for it. He began converting people by force. This produced a rebellion in Granada, the Emirate of Granada. And on the back of that rebellion, Ferdinand and Isabella said, okay, you rebelled, so we're going to convert you. You've got to become Catholics. So that's what they did in Granada. And then, they were basically forcibly making the Muslims of Granada be baptized and so on. So this process spread all across Spain bit by bit. So is there a bit of an echo here? I'm still here, so it goes. By 1520, all the Muslims in Spain had been converted, forcibly converted, or with varying degrees of pressure. So ostensibly, by about 1525, there were no Muslims left in Spain, if you looked on the surface. All the Muslims in Spain, whether it was Valencia, Granada, Castile, Murcia, had all been converted, and they were known as Moriscos, which actually meant little Moor. They were also known sometimes as new Moors, from new Christians from Moors. So, once again, Spain was faced with the same dynamic that had happened before with the Jews. They had basically told Muslims, you have to become like us if you want to stay here. And then once they forced them to do that, they didn't use words like assimilation in those days. These are words we use, but they didn't use them. But nevertheless, that was what they were doing. It was a process of forced assimilation. The concept of tolerance, as we understand it now, did not really exist in 16th century Spain. The idea was that there were very few Spaniards who would say, for example, we can have Jews, Muslims, and Christians living separately within the same space. There had been once in the Middle Ages, but that things have changed a lot since then. There were even fewer who would say that we can coexist with Muslims in the same place. It was raised in one of the debates earlier, this idea of the ancestral Islamic enemy as a way of not only an enemy that you fight against, but an enemy that you help define yourself. This is what Spain was doing in the 16th century. In the 16th century, Spain was not Spain as we know it now. So it wasn't a nation state as such. It was a Habsburg kingdom. That meant it was being governed by Austrian rulers, basically, and an Austrian king. And it was also the union of two kingdoms, Castile and Aragon. Nevertheless, there was this process going on throughout the 16th century in which Spain was becoming the dominant military power in Europe. And one of the ways that the Spanish rulers understood their military power was they gained their power from God. God gave them power, and God gave them legitimacy to use their power in Europe. Another important thing to bear in mind is that when Spain became the kind of Spain of the Counter-Reformation, when it was actually militarily trying to wipe out Protestantism in Europe, Protestant propaganda would often say, this Spanish king is telling us how to be Christians when he has Moors living in his own country. So there was a certain amount of inferiority among Spanish rulers at that time. They felt that having had this Islamic presence for 800 years was a kind of defilement. It contaminated them. And therefore, it was always a problem, a serious problem, a cultural problem, a religious problem, and as I'll mention later, a security problem. One of the problems, when I talk about bad policy, mistakes, and wrong turns, Spanish rulers did not understand any distinction between religion and culture, as we understand it now. We're often now able to make distinctions between what a religious practice is and what a cultural practice is. Spanish rulers couldn't do that, or wouldn't do it. So, therefore, they, once they had converted all the Moriscos and made them into Christians, they became obsessed with the idea that these Moriscos were not good Christians. They were not, that really they were secretly worshipping as Muslims. And one of the ways, how do they know this? Well, they didn't actually know it, because Moriscos had very different responses to their forced conversions. Some of them just accepted, they thought, okay, we have no choice but to be Christians, we just will accept it and do it. Others resisted. Others they resisted mostly culturally. Like, for example, they paid lip service to Christianity. They would, but then behind the scenes, they would actually do the best to worship as Muslims. But from the point of view of Catholic Spain and the Inquisition, they found any evidence of cultural difference as a sign that the Moriscos were really all secret Muslims. So they constructed this image of the homogenous, monolithic enemy, in which everybody was the same, with no room for variation at all. Let's look at some of these factors. For example, dances. There were all kinds of dances that were very popular amongst Spanish Moors, like the Zambra, for example. These dances were popular, and they didn't necessarily have any religious connotations whatsoever. In fact, some imams, as we call them at the time, condemned these dances because they said they were against Islam and so on. But from the point of view of the Inquisition, if you were doing things like this, then you were probably secretly worshipping as a Muslim. Notice the skin colour. This is a drawing painting from the early 16th century. People often think of the expulsion in racial terms, i.e. Moors were dark and Spanish were white. It wasn't ever like that, actually. In terms of skin colour, there wasn't necessarily any difference that Moors were dark or Spanish were white. This is the 20th century interpretation that's been placed upon it. So, another thing that's obsessed the Christians, the church at that time, were what Morisco women were wearing. That should ring a few bells, I'm sure. They were particularly obsessed with the almalafa, as it was called. They thought, they tried to wipe it out, they tried to ban it, because, bizarrely, what they thought women who looked like this were actually engaging in secret sexual relationships. That's what they thought. And they thought they were encouraging Christian women to do the same thing. They didn't like the idea that women could walk around with their faces covered. So they tried to stop this practice in various ways. They passed laws against it. They imposed fines. Sometimes women were flogged for wearing it, and so on. So you have this, once again, you begin to move towards forced assimilation, the policing of assimilation by the Inquisition. The Inquisition basically acted as a kind of cultural police, watching the Moriscos all the time, trying to find out what they were doing. They would pass laws saying, for example, the Moriscos have to leave their doors open on Fridays in case they were secretly worshipping as Muslims, and so on. They, if you ate couscous, they would say, you must be secretly worshipping as a Muslim. If you wash your face, they would say, you're doing that because you're about to pray, and so on. So they have all these things began to kind of weigh heavily down on the Moriscos. The Moriscos were essentially trapped in a very difficult situation. They had a Christian society that was insistent on making them into Christians, and yet wouldn't accept that they couldn't be Christians because they had once been Moors. They weren't allowed to leave the country. That was another thing. The Spain's rulers would not allow the Moriscos to leave in case they became enemies and joined the North African Corsairs or the Ottoman Sultan's troops and so on. So Spain created a situation for itself which could only end badly. The other thing was that Spain's rulers would always say, okay, we want these people to become Christians, but they never provided priests to go and speak to them. Sometimes there were some Morisco parts of Spain who would never see a priest for about 6 months, even then. So they didn't actually know what they were supposed to be doing. All they did was they were baptized, and then the churches forgot about them and left them. So, naturally in that case, people reverted back to their old religion. But not, once again, I should stress, not universally. These kind of cultural practices went on for about 40 years. The Spain's rulers alternated between punishing Moriscos for looking like this and then giving them periods of grace in which they say, okay, look, you've got 10 years to become Christians. And then we'll come back and look in 10 years and see if you are. But by the middle of the 16th century, they lost patience. And this is when things begin to move towards the genocide, or what I call the genocide imagination. It's very important to wear. It's also important if you consider the time that we're in now. We now live in a state of what is increasingly becoming permanent war. It's not war. It's a strange kind of war, because quite often here in Europe, we don't even know we are at war until something happens to remind us of it. But in the 16th century, Spain was also at permanent war. It was engaged in permanent war with the Sultan, with the Ottoman Turks mostly. Particularly in the middle of the 16th century, there was a ferocious struggle going on for control of the Western Mediterranean between Habsburg Spain and the Ottoman Sultan. So this made Spanish rulers very insecure about the populations within their own midst. The other thing about Spain is a contradiction about Spain. Spain was the most powerful country in Europe in the 16th century, the militarily dominant power, the only power able to put about 300,000 people into the field in wars overall. So it was very powerful, but it was also very weak, very vulnerable to attacks on its coastline, for example. The Spanish Mediterranean coastline was almost indefensible, and it was constantly being raided by North African pirates known as corsairs at the time. And so sometimes there were cases, particularly in Valencia, where the Moriscos helped them. They saw them as their allies, and they would assist them. And so, you know, Spain felt itself to be basically under siege. That's how it saw it. A lot of Spain's problems were created by itself, it must be said. But nevertheless, they felt themselves to be under siege from outside. And they began to see the Moriscos as a fifth column. Obviously, they didn't use words like fifth column, they used 20th century words. Nevertheless, that's exactly what they did. If you look at Inquisition reports from the 16th century, you know, you're probably familiar in the last couple of weeks with this nonsense about Muslim no-go zones in France and so on. Fox News has been talking more about this. You know, the idea that there are little neighborhoods all over Europe that are now completely governed by Sharia law and so on, and they're engaged in sedition, etc., against their respective governments. The same kind of ideas were around in 16th century Spain. Inquisition reports will say, we wish to report to you, Your Majesty, that the Moriscos of such and such a village in Valencia are engaged in sedition. How do we know this? We don't know it, because they haven't actually gone into these places. They will just hear a bit of conversation here, somebody would say this. So they basically constructed a convenient image. And basically, Spain's rulers began to think, okay, the only way we can eliminate this security risk is we have to be even more, use even more coercion to make the Moriscos become like us. And this was particularly applied to Granada, which is the most kind of culturally and religiously Islamic part of Spain at the time, because it had been so close to North Africa for so many years. So in 1568, Philip II made a disastrous decision in which he passed this official decree, and he said to the Moriscos of Granada, you must stop speaking Arabic within the next year and start speaking Spanish, all of you. You must destroy all documents written in Arabic, all bathhouses must be destroyed, all dances are banned, no one was made down the Malafa, and so on. So the Moriscos were basically, Granada, were pushed right against the wall. What did they do? They did what many people would do in a similar situation. They rebelled. And this began the war known as the War of the Alpujarras, the Alpujarras Mountains, in Granada. It was concentrated mostly in Alpujarras. It was a vicious war, one of the worst civil wars Spain ever experienced, and certainly the worst war of the 16th century. It involved foreign mujahideen coming from North Africa and Turkish volunteers who actually went to Granada to fight alongside the Moriscos. The Moriscos lost. They lost and they were punished severely for it. The king deported the entire population of Granada and just basically dispersed them all over Spain. The idea was that if you dispersed the Moriscos in small groups all over Spain, they would no longer become a security risk. And they would be diluted culturally and religiously into the surrounding population. That was the idea. Once again, as soon as Spain's rulers had done this, they didn't believe it was actually happening. And then in the second half of the 16th century, Spain became absolutely obsessed with what it called the Morisco question. And this is where you start to see the genocidal imagination come into play. If you read documents of the Council of State at the time, letters passed back and forth between leading clerics, such as the Archbishop of Valencia, Juan de Rivera. If you read those letters, you see very 20th century solutions being proposed to this Morisco question. They debated, for example, should we just simply kill them all? That was one. What about castrating all the men? That was another. Then somebody else suggested, let's take all the Moriscos in ships, take them to the Mediterranean, drown a lot of them. That was another. Then there was another, put them in reservations. Put the whole lot of them and keep them in reservations until they starve to death. Another. And then there was one more, expulsion. Why not simply remove the whole population? So Spain's rulers taught, this was taught back and forth for years. Nothing ever happened. Why didn't anything ever happen? Well, one of the things you have to understand about Christian Spain was not monolithic. It was not entirely in favor of expelling the Moriscos. I can't say that there were many people in Christian Spain in the 16th century who were in favor of coexistence with Islam. Very few. And if anybody ever mentioned that, they would have been locked up by the Inquisition themselves. Nevertheless, there were Spanish Christians who believed that you should not be forcing people to become what they don't want to be, that you should allow time. So that these arguments went back and forth, expulsion or allow more time for the Moriscos to become like us. That was the basic, that was as far as 16th century tolerance went. When we use words like tolerance now, they have very different meanings to what we had in the 16th century. So these arguments were tossed back and forth. It's also another thing to remember is that a lot of Christian landowners did not want to expel the Moriscos because their livelihood and their money and their income and their profits depended on Morisco labor. Particularly in Valencia and Aragon, the Moriscos were absolutely crucial to the local economy. And so the king of Spain wasn't all powerful. He couldn't actually, just because he wanted to do something, always get it. So the Valencian nobles opposed these kind of things. They said, no, we're not going to do this. Why should we do it? And the king was not in a strong enough position to do much about it. So this debate about the Morisco question went on and on, expel, don't expel, until Philip II of Spain died, and his son, Philip III, took the throne. I often make this is a comparison that historians won't like, but it often always occurs to me. I always think of Philip III as being like George Bush Jr. Because Philip III was a weak king and a weak man, whereas his father was a strong, dominant, anti-heretic, anti-Muslim, anti-Protestant fighter. And so Philip III, the only thing he really did in his entire career was expel the Moriscos. And the decision was taken in 1609, it was in April 1609 the decision was taken. Historians still don't understand why they suddenly decided to expel the Moriscos. Because the most likely explanation is that in 1609 there was an opportunity to do it. Because in the years before, Spain was always fighting somebody. There was hardly a single year in Spain wasn't at war. So in order to expel 350,000 people, you need a lot of resources. You need soldiers, ships, police, all kinds of things, a lot of organization. And the astounding thing about what happened in 1609 is that Spain was not always the most effective state. And yet when it came to expulsion, they proved to be very, very good at it, at least at the beginning. Because within just 3-4 months, they managed to mobilize a huge fleet of ships off the coast of Valencia.